You were homosexual and you also did have, you know, girls. So you played both sides of the fence. You were on drugs. I believe you used crack, right? Was crack?
Yeah, heroin too.
And heroin, my goodness. And not only that, you had full-blown AIDS before there was a cure, something to stop it. My name is Dr. Iglesias, and this is Deep in Your Business. Today, I have my good friend, and his name is Pastor Josh, man. We want to welcome you, man. Praise God. So what's
Thanks
up, brother?
Thanks a lot for having me here, man. It's awesome.
Yeah,
to
man.
To be here and
amen.
Sitting here with you at this moment of our lives.
Yeah, man. This is such
after
a blessing.
We've seen so many processes in our lives.
Oh, yeah. And you're here with your brothers. What's his name?
Leonardo Antunes.
Leonardo
Antunes.
Antunes. ¿Y usted?
Mi nombre es Jason Gutierrez.
Jason Gutierrez. And where did you fly in from?
I flew in from Jersey, from South Jersey.
South Jersey. What a blessing to have you here. Mike Casanova couldn't make it in Alvaro, but man, we're going to dig in because your testimony is so powerful, man. It really, it blows my socks off. And for you to be so transparent, man, one of my concerns were like when your congregants watch this, they're going to be like, man, I didn't know that deep, dark past. Because I'm sure you've given your testimony, but you probably have never dove in that deep before. They don't know you personally like that. But I remember meeting you in high school, man, and I would always see you with a tourage of women, all these women. And you had contact lenses on. I'm sure you remember that.
Yep.
And you were really flamboyant. But you was this guy that, even though I knew you were homosexual, I was scared to fight with you because I was like, bro, what if I don't win that fight? You know, because you look tough, bro. You were a tough guy in high school, man. So
one of the things that a lot of people freak out on because they tend to stereotype people a lot of times.
Hmm.
And between high school, I never went in and went into that lifestyle.
What?
And it was just a point that, you know what, I've seen all of these guys in school just trying to act all cool, bad, this. And really, it was just a point of just getting to the heart of the girls. And
wow.
A lot of people think that it's just being tough, being this.
Right.
But sometimes women just don't need that in their lives. And
bro, they felt so comfortable with you.
They used to come to speak to me about their problems with their boyfriends, and I was just their pillow to just hang out with.
Dude, that was crazy. So then you kind of dove into the life of homosexuality. How that was after high school then?
Actually, that was after the drugs.
Okay.
That was during the process that I went into being addicted to crack and heroin.
Oh, wow.
And I just started just rebounding, finding fast money, the way to make money. Just finding a way to just prostitute myself or just look for money. I started dancing, stripping, and just between that whole lifestyle, I mean, obviously it takes you into just experimenting different types of things in life.
Wow. You know what's crazy? That what you're telling me is kind of the street norm, but guys don't speak about that. A lot of guys that are on heroin and crack to do just to feed their addiction, bro, they'll do anything. And it's so crazy that you'll just open up so naturally, man. So praise God.
Eventually, the lifestyle that you decide to walk in through is something that takes you into something else.
Mm.
You understand? And it's sadly because the majority of the people that you bump into, it's usually the ones that are selling the dope, the ones that are trying to give you something, but they want something in return because they find themselves in a lockdown in different ways.
Got that. Wow, that's amazing. So what was your first experience with a man? Was it because, you know, take me through that.
Well, it wasn't the point of a first experience. It was just the point of just finding yourself in a situation with a whole bunch of people just getting drugged up and then just waking up and not knowing what really happened.
Oh, my goodness. So it was like an orgy type of thing?
It was definitely just, you know, going into places that there was orgies happening, things happening. And when you find yourself in that situation, you find yourself in the point that you don't know what you're going in through, what you're working in through, what's going to happen in between that process of your life.
Wow, that's amazing. So I know that you told me you one day you went to go get a blood test, and it came back that you were HIV positive. How did that, how was that story?
Well, the crazy thing about that was, I mean, taking it off the topic, I mean, I OD on crack. I could say, like, I could tell you very clearly, man, I OD on crack, and I overcame it, but it was just by, like, doing a call out to God, saying, hey, you know what? Mm. I'll serve you if I survive this.
Wow.
And in between that point of surviving, seeing my soul leaving my body,
yeah,
and then just seeing it come right back into my body and just breaking free from that. But in that same old process, I was going through the process that I was addicted to a drug. I was addicted to crack. I was addicted to heroin. Wow. And in between that process, I end up picking up A's some way down the line.
Wow.
And after I said, you know what, I'm going to pull back from the drugs. I'm going to pull back from everything. I'm just going to change my lifestyle.
Mm.
Automatically, what happened was a few months later, I used to sell my blood for money at the blood banks, and they discovered that I had full-blown A's.
Wow. Wow.
And that was in a point of life that A's wasn't something you wanted somebody around you with.
Exactly. You know, it's like, what year was that, more or less?
This was back in, like, 98, around
wow.
there. And finding myself in that situation,
yeah,
it just became a big silence in my life. But I remember that I looked at that doctor, and I'm like, hey, what's up, man? He's like, no. I mean, we got good news and we got bad news. We know when you picked it up, and we know when that you're right now, you're practically dying.
Wow.
I'm like, so you're telling me that a few months later, you found out that I had AIDS, but you kept receiving my blood and you're experimenting on it.
Wow.
That's and now crazy. Is when you're going to sit here and tell me what's
that's
up.
Insane. And,
but at the same time, I looked at him. I'm like, Ben, 2 weeks ago, I OD on crack. I was dying.
Wow.
And
Ben was the doctor.
I told the doctor.
The doctor.
I
okay.
told the doctor. Yeah. I was ODing on crack, and now I'm here.
Oh, wow.
And a week and a half ago, they were shooting at my face.
What?
And with a gun and just shooting. And I saw the bullets go everywhere, and it hit me. And I looked at him. And I'm like, somebody wants me here in
right.
this world.
Wow.
Somebody wants me. And he looks at me very clearly in my face, and he tells me, don't you understand that you're finna die? You are dying. You're rotten inside. You're gonna die. There's no solution for you.
Wow.
There's no meds. You're allergic to everything. And we have no solution for you. You need to go home and die.
Wow.
You have a few months to live.
My goodness. And yeah, back then, I remember in our neighborhood, our friends were just dropping like flies to catch AIDS. And it was fast. It was so fast, man.
Definitely, definitely. And wow. I mean, you saw people just last few months and... But happens to be that since that time to here, it's been 38 years, man.
Wow.
And I'm here standing alive, healthy, you know.
It's crazy.
Living a good life.
I remember that you told me that the doctor kept, because you were negative. So that was 98. When was it showing negative?
Well, it started showing negative. It started showing negative like in 2014.
Oh, wow.
2014, 2015 around there, and it was just crazy because they didn't understand what was going on.
Wow.
They were like, whoa, what's going on in your life? You know, your immune system is just completely changing.
Wow.
But there was one point in my life that I flew into New York and I came back from vacation, and it was crazy because in that period of time, I felt like my body collapsed.
Oh, wow.
I was like, whoa, this is it. And I went to the doctor and they told me, man, look, man, there's only one medication that we could start you with. And we could start you with that like yesterday.
Right.
But we need you to do some tests. And man, when I went home, I was like, you know what, God? It's like, if you want me to take this med, let it be your will. But if you don't, I told him, if you don't want me to take this med, you do something. I went and I took the test. The doctor calls me back and he tells me, man, are you standing up or are you sitting down? And I'm like, okay, this man's going to tell me I'm going to die any moment. You
right,
know,
the
doctor
right.
tells you that.
Yeah.
You're not,
yeah.
Whoa, I am going to die.
Wow.
And in that moment that he tells me that, I say, okay, I'm sitting down. He's like, well, I don't know what are you doing, But whatever you're doing, you need to keep doing it because your immune system just completely just shift.
Wow.
And I was like, whoa. You know, and I obviously I know who that came from.
Right.
Because there was no medication that I was drinking. You know, the only thing I was drinking was just drinking a lot of OJ juice with carrots.
Right, right.
You know, that's not going to help me.
Right.
But it's just crazy, you know, and it's like the whole process went by. I remember 14 years after that, I'm sitting up in a prayer meeting and I said, you know what, God, is like, I was supposed to be dead a few years ago. Why am I still here? And the only thing I heard was, you never came looking for healing.
Wow.
You never came looking for a miracle.
Wow.
You came to just be willing to expand my kingdom.
Wow.
You know, and it might sound crazy for a lot of people that don't understand what is seeking for a miracle in your life. A lot of us, we try to seek for miracles in all kinds of different ways.
Yeah.
You understand? But there's one thing that only could intervene. And is the creator of everything.
Yeah.
That's the only thing.
Wow. That's powerful, man. I feel God's presence, man. So powerful.
And a lot of times we're like, hey, what's up, man? What's going on? I find people all the time. I'm like, man, you know what? There's a solution in life. Yeah, there's moments to change in our lives.
Yeah.
There's things. But you know what? One of the first things that need to change in your life is your mentality,
that's
the way
right.
you think, the way you look at things.
Yes.
You know, I grew up in a very urban community. I could say the ghetto,
the
ghetto of Miami.
Yeah.
You understand? And it's like there was no expectation for anybody.
Not at all.
You know, a lot of people said, hey, there was no expectation for me by the state of Florida. I'm mentally retarded.
Yeah.
Man, I grew up, I couldn't speak when I was a kid. I started speaking when I was, you know, speaking well when I was in seventh grade. And I still, there's points now that I can't barely speak. But you know what? It was just a point of the way your mentality changes, the way you think, the way you say, you know what? I need to get out of this hole that I'm into and just doing something new.
You know what I keep hearing is that you made yourself available. There's something about just making yourself available that God just recycles you, you know? So I know that you're a pastor now, and maybe, again, a lot of your congregants are going to watch this and be like, man, I didn't know he was in the ghetto, and I didn't know he had this lifestyle, and I didn't know he dealt with AIDS, and, you know, but you're just a miracle because you have four girls?
I got four girls and a granddaughter.
Four girls and a granddaughter. Man, it's just so amazing. It seems like just you were supposed to be out of the game a long time ago, you know?
Definitely.
My goodness.
And it's always going to be a battle.
Right.
What's going to always be a battle?
Yes.
You know what, man? It's like one thing could come out of another one. Right now, to this point in my life, I'm living, how can I tell you? I'm living consequences of what I live. You know, and I could just do a shout out to all the people that are here at this moment. Sometimes you don't see the consequence now. So you see it years later. I'm living consequences of things that I lived.
Wow.
And a lot of times we don't understand. We're like, okay, you know what? They say this. You know, let me tell you a story. Your parents tell you, hey, man, don't walk with your shoes off on the cold feet.
Right.
Because when you get old, you're going to get arthritis.
Right, right, right.
And we look at them, we're like, man, this old man, this woman don't know what they're talking about.
They, right,
that exactly. was in their ages. But you know what? Right. Now you feel it.
It's wisdom.
Now you feel the consequences.
Right, right.
So then our actions, you know, and I'm shouting out to those people out there that you got a chance to just change situations in your life, you know?
Yeah,
if you're a compulsive liar, you need to say, you know what? From this day on, I'm going to speak the truth.
Yes.
You understand?
Yes.
Even if it hurts.
Yes.
Because that's one thing that sometimes we don't want to speak the truth because we think it's going to hurt somebody.
Correct.
But you know what? The truth always sets something free.
That's it.
It always do. So it's a consequence of what you decide to change in your life.
Yes, man. So take us through that moment where they put a gun to your face and they started shooting. Like, what happened?
Well, it was crazy because that moment, I mean, I could tell you where it was at. It was on Flagler and 12th Street.
Okay.
Flagler and 12th Avenue.
Wow.
And I remember I was acting like I was hustling. And when this man came out to, like, try to pick me up, I just turned around and just robbed him. For his money. So I'm walking down 12th Avenue back towards the neighborhood. And when I come to see, this man is just driving up on me. And he just drives up on me and he just starts shooting. Oof. And shooting. I remember that night I ran. I was running everywhere. And everywhere that I was, it's like, this man, I don't know where he was taking out so many bullets from. Right. I was like, whoa, man.
Wow.
But he just stood in front of me and he just started shooting at right at my face.
Wow.
And I just saw the bullets leave. I mean, I was just seeing them just going everywhere else but hitting me.
Wow.
So I could take you to that night, man. I remember that night, man. I was like, whoa, this is crazy. You know, like, my heart wanted to blow up.
Wow.
My heart wanted to blow up, you know? But here I am.
That's crazy. That is so... I mean, we can always look back and know that God, either he assigned an angel in our lives or God himself was protecting you. I mean, and think about it. This is before you gave your life to Jesus. This is before you were born again.
But you know what's the funny part about it is I grew up in a church.
Hmm.
I lived the whole church scene. Yeah. I lived that beautiful, nice kid in church. I lived the whole thing. Yeah. But the crazy part about it is that at the age of 12 years old, I saw so much religion
that
I started losing faith on the religion.
Oh, wow.
I was like, wait a minute, this is fake. Because they sitting here up in church telling me that, hey, man, you know, you have a problem with your vision. You can't see well. You have dyslexia. You can't read and write. But if you ask God for a miracle, God's going to do it.
Hmm.
So as a kid, I'm going home bringing up a prayer storm.
Right.
And I open my eyes and I don't see this miracle, but I see other miracles going on, but nothing's happening in my life.
Right.
You know, and at the age of 12 years old, I'm like, man, I don't want to know about a church.
Wow.
I don't want to know about any of this. And I started, and at that moment, I started speaking to the enemy, to the devil.
Hmm.
I started saying, you know what? And at the age of 14, I said, you know what? I'm going to make a covenant that anything I lay eyes on, I will reap.
Wow. I made the same covenant, but go ahead.
I will lay eyes on. Yeah. But at the same time, he came through.
Right. Yeah.
He came through 100%.
Yeah.
He came through. So my covenant was, I'm going to make this covenant, but then this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to steal people's faith because I know how to preach the gospel.
Wow.
I know how to speak the Christian life. I know how to speak what it says.
Right.
So I would just go up in there and I would just start speaking to people. And then I would just have them to just make a covenant that they can't receive Christ like their Lord and Savior. Wow. That was my whole ideal.
That's crazy.
But I was reaping what I wanted.
Right. I just wanted women and money. That's all I wanted.
That's one of the things I was looking for, women and money. And it's like,
wow, but yours is deep.
And I end up getting into more stuff. Well, actually, what I wanted was sex and money.
Right.
But my purpose was in laying with all kind of crazy things that I didn't even know what the hell I was laying with.
Right.
You understand? Right. It was just, I was just drugged up. I mean, could you imagine? And I could tell you right now that there's probably people out there hearing it. How many times you woke up in a bed that you don't know what the hell happened or who you've been with?
Yeah.
And you just look around and it's like, what happened today?
Wow.
You understand? Yeah. What happened to me last night?
Right.
What I did? You know, that's what happened.
Yeah.
You know, I had this lady one time come up at me in church and says, hey, man, I need you to pray for me. I need you to pray for my son. And I looked at her, I'm like, okay, I'll pray for your son. But she got four sons. He's like, yeah, I need you to pray for this son. And he's, you know, he had the same problem you got. You know, you had. And I'm like, well, what are you talking about? He's like, he's gay. I'm like, no, listen, lady, when have you ever heard me say I was gay? I was never gay.
Right.
I mean, I went into what I went to because of drugs.
Ah,
you understand? It wasn't like I was like, oh, man, I'm just looking for a man in my life.
No, man,
this ain't life like that. You know, I was just hooked on something.
Right.
But in between the whole thing, you know what? It takes you all into that. It takes you all into that, you know?
Okay.
You start seeing all this crazy stuff. You start seeing, you know, okay, this is a way quick money.
Right.
Let's make quick money. Let's move somewhere else. Why? Because I had a goal. My goal was to be able to conquer something that the world wasn't telling me I was going to conquer. That I wasn't going to be successful.
Got it. Because of the dyslexia and all the challenges.
The lack of reading and everything.
Wow.
And I'll tell you right now, you might see me and you might say, okay, yeah, but he a pastor. I mean, what happened to the dyslexia? You know what? I still got it. I still can't read and write. The second woman in my life is called Siri on my phone. She helped me do everything.
Man, and listen, if you would have never told me that, because remember, I saw you in high school, and again, because you wasn't that tough guy, I said he has to be homosexual for him to be with you to be with
tough
all these
guy,
women.
I used to love to fight. That I was know, one but of what I meant, I loved.
What I meant was your mannerism, the way you would dress, the way the women were comfortable
well,
around
you. Well,
you got
to remember one thing. So, we grew up in a ghetto school,
right?
And I was dressed. I used to dress up like a preppy boy.
Yes, I know.
You understand?
So to us, that was not. You know?
Yeah. You get me? So now I see niggas out there doing their eyebrows, right. And I find it strange.
Yeah.
I'm like, listen, when I was in the world, I saw niggas doing their eyebrows. You understand? And they were going up there thinking they were Dolly Parton.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah.
Now I see men doing them, and I'm like, well, what's up here now?
Yeah,
everything want to switch around, you know, dyeing your hair, dyeing your goatee, you know? Come on.
Hey, now. Let's not talk about my beard now, man. I don't want it white. So yeah, but it was the everything. You had the contact lens. It was a pretty boy, you know, but pretty boy wasn't the thing in the hood, you see?
Yeah, I mean, in the hood, you go out to parties, you all go out, do booty dancing.
Yeah.
You do this, you do that. But I used to go out and party, do all those same dances. But at the same time, I was up on South Beach in the kitchen club, the rock clubs, doing all this. So it was different atmosphere. But I knew that was calling attention from the girls.
Right.
It's just like, everybody wanted football in school. I got into dance classes. Why? Because dance classes had all the chicks inside. Yeah. Yep. I got into homemade economics. All the classes had all the girls. I'm like, y'all want to go out there and push around boys. Y'all go around there and push around boys.
Right, but right.
I'm just here. I'm just here giving support to your women.
Right.
That's all to it.
So I remember that, Josh. And then I remember your lifestyle. And then one day I walk into a church. It was a Rey Jesus on the Beach that someone invited me there. And I see you preaching. And I'm like, there is no way that this man can be saved. Like, I was in total shock to hear you preaching. Now, you say dyslexia. Brother, you can quote that Bible. You can read that Bible. So it must be that when you're under the anointing, all that dyslexia, all the defects that the enemy tries to bring, it just removes because you're anointed. I've seen God use you in healing. Deliverance. I've seen God use you preaching salvation, and to see this guy in high school and everything that you went through to now preaching the word of God, that impacted my life. And I was said, there's no way that you can be saved. And man, I've seen God just do miracles, because not only did he heal you from AIDS, but now you have four little girls, you're married.
Well, the funny thing about it is sometimes I ask the Lord, I say, Lord, there's no way I could be saved.
Hmm.
How did your mercy did come upon my life? And I questioned the Lord. I questioned the Lord a lot of times on that. Why I questioned him. And I'm like, whoa, man, God. I remember I used to go steal. And I used to cover myself with the blood of Jesus.
Wow.
I used to ask the Holy Spirit to protect me while I was stealing.
That's crazy.
You know? And at the same time here, calling upon Satan.
Mm.
And I'm like, man, God, your mercy was really, your mercy really has something, you know, and to this day, you know, and not that long ago, it's crazy because not that long ago, I do Uber, and I like doing Uber because it let me communicate myself with people. Mm. It let me speak to people.
Yeah.
And I'm not a religious person. You won't catch me out there, you know, quoting the Bible to people. I just try to open people's eyes that there is something else that just life. There is something else than just what the world has to offer us.
Right.
So, you know, and I'm driving and I'm like, you know what, God? It's like, we're all sinners.
Mm.
You know, but your word says that you forgive and you forget.
Right.
And I tell the Lord, I'm like, why you forgive and you forget and we still go through all these processes?
Mm.
And he's like, because you forgive. Mm. I forgive and I forget, but you don't forget what you came from and the enemy don't forget.
Mm.
You get me? It's just like your neighbor.
Right.
Your neighbor will never forget the mistakes you did.
Right.
But he will never remember the good you did.
Of course.
So that's the way we live, you know?
Right.
You know? And that's one of the things that we're like, whoa. That's one of the things that, you know, we stop. I stop and I think, I'm like, how can I reach somebody?
Yeah.
if I can't, if I'm going to judge that person.
Right.
See, because a lot of us don't want to know God because we're thinking about how people are going to judge us. Mm. Just like you said, yeah. There's no way that person could be saved.
Right. Right. We judge by mere appearance.
The you Bible see, but says, God don't. Needs right. God needs people to say, there's no way, because that's where absolutely. He's going to come through.
That's it.
You understand? So yep. No matter what you're going through out there, no yeah. matter what you go through,
right.
You know, God will make you go through.
Yeah.
My God will give yeah. you the strength of all
remember,
of
I wasn't the only one in shock. You were in shock looking at me.
Oh, yeah. When I saw you, I was like in shock. I'm like, wait a minute. Because I was like, man, this nigga don't fall down from me. We fall from the same tree.
Right.
You understand? And right, then we start right. working together. That was the crazy yes. stuff because yes. we did not yes. get along.
Right.
You know? We, yes. we it was just like a right. moment of a rooster fight just yep. going on, you know? Yep. Who yep. got more power here, yep. you know? Well, we just bust on the song. Who got the power and just right, go right. at it, you know?
Yeah.
And then just working together for so many years, that's something ministry, that's just yeah. impacting.
Yes, yes. Yes, I've seen you move in the prophetic. I know you hear God's voice. I've seen you move in the prophetic, man. I've seen you move mightily. And what I want to make clear is when we say that we're not religious, you see, in the Old Testament, there were the Pharisees, Sadducees, and the scribes. There were the modern-day religious people. We're talking about now the modern-day religious people that were like the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes. Jesus said, do what they say, but don't do what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we describe religious people, for those that don't understand, being a Christian is not being religious. So being a Christian is being Christ-like, is believing in Christ, living a life for him. And basically what you read is how you live your day-by-day life. You're not living lukewarm. In Revelation 3:16 says either you're hot, you're cold. If you're lukewarm, I'll throw you up. So a religious person, whenever we say that, is a person that basically don't say what they're saying, they're not living. So
well, that's one of the things, you know, that I and said, like you were saying, you preach the gospel, you do this, you do that. And you said something in the very beginning. Mm. Maybe some of the people that, you know, in your congregation
right.
don't know what you live.
Right.
Man, I'm an open book.
Good.
I'm an open book in everything. And you know what? I do a calling, and I'm the first one on the calling.
Mm.
Because you know what? None of us fall short.
Right.
You understand? And I could preach something, but you know what? If I ain't living what I'm preaching,
yeah,
I'm going up to the altar to repent at the same time.
Yeah.
You know, and that's one of the things that a lot of people don't do. People freak yeah. out. So a lot of people tell me, religious people tell me all the time, hey, man, but you know what? In your preachings, you always talk about your testimony. I'm like, what else am I going to talk about? I ain't going to talk about your testimony.
Exactly.
You understand? I ain't living what you're living. Yes. I don't know if you got a heart that has changed, but I got things that changed in my life.
Amen.
You know
what it is? People don't like transparency.
Oh, no.
They're afraid of it. And I remember when I was transparent from the beginning, the pastors would tell me, well, you can't be transparent like that. I'm like, why? You want me to put on a religious garment? Yeah. There's only certain people you can confess it. No, I'm going to be open with everyone. You read about Peter. You read about Paul. They're just open. All the men of the Bible are open. Why can I not be open? And I learned that there's a lot of hypocrisy. Now, why is it important to be open? Look at T.D. Jakes right now. Now, is it a fact? I don't know. But there's a lot of things that are coming out with T.D. Jakes. Look at Pastor Bob Coy. You know, there was a lot of things that he did in darkness that now, you know, came to pass. And you can hide it for so long. But there's something about transparency.
Well, yeah. One of the things is, yeah. this is one of the things that a lot of people, there's a pastor out there that he's a man of God, a powerful man of God, you know, and he's an awesome preacher, an awesome teacher of the Word of God. And he was confronted by something he said online.
Hmm.
He started saying, in the end times, we're going to see a lot of false prophets, false this, false that, false that.
Right.
But a lot of times, we want to blame a false prophet for something. We want to blame a pastor for something. We want to blame. And that's why a lot of times nowadays, there's men and women of God that are not willing to go out there and speak.
Mm.
You know, hey, I'm going through this challenge. I need help.
Right.
You know, why? Right. Because you know what? Those wolves that are sheeps,
mm-hmm.
that are with wrong clothing, that they feel like they're going to be exposed.
Right.
You know,
right.
And that's why a lot of times nowadays we got all this going on with these pastors
yeah.
and these prophets and these apostles that are doing yeah. all these crazy stuff. But you know what? A lot of times it's just best to be open. Yeah. Be open, be an open yeah. book. You know what? You know what? Like I tell people, you know what? Put your trust in God, but don't yeah. put it on men.
Yes. Cursed is the man that trusts in a man.
That yep. trusts in a man.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not that you're going to put your trust. You could believe in a man, but not trust, not put your life on his faith.
Right, right. And I think there's a lot of people that are being exposed right now, not just in the church. I'm talking about, look at P. Diddy. Look, you know, everything in darkness is going to come to light. But I think that when you're in sin and you're deep, deep, dark in sin, you really feel you're not going to get caught. And look at Epstein, you know?
Well, that's one of the things of the enemy. He's going to roll and roll and roll until he can expose you.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
Until he can expose you.
So how did you repent? When did you have this encounter with God? Because you made a pact with Satan, and yet you were juggling Satan, juggling God. And when did you say, this is it?
When did I say, this is it? This is the most powerful thing. When I OD'd on crack. The second time I OD'd on crack, that I saw that I was dying and my friends threw me to the floor. I says, you know what, God? If you deliver me from this, I will serve you for the rest of my life.
Wow.
And that's when he came through and he delivered me from it.
Wow.
And that's what from there on, I said, you know what? This is the moment. And like I tell you, you could go out there, you could believe in a man of God, you could believe in this, you could believe in that, you could hear this, you could hear this preaching, you could hear this teaching. But you know what? From there on, I started building a relationship. I started really building a relationship with the Spirit of God.
Got it. Okay.
I started telling Spirit of God, I need you to help me. I need you to let me overcome this.
Yes.
And trust me, one of the biggest things that it was the strongest thing for me to overcome, it wasn't the drugs. It wasn't, you know what it was? The addiction that I have for music.
Really?
That was the biggest challenge I had in my life.
Wow.
You understand? Because that was one of my biggest weaknesses. I wanted to just dance. That was my biggest battle. And as I was going through that battle of being free from that, you understand?
Yeah.
And being free from what was sexual immorality.
Yeah.
That was one of the biggest things. But little by little, eventually I started turning my heart into God, seeking his spirit, and his spirit just started giving me the strength to overcome it.
Amen.
And be set free from it.
So I watched your life, man, unfold. Like now you have a church building. It's so awesome. You have your congregants here, and man, I've seen your life blossom because, listen, man, you came from a rough life like I did. And just like people had doubt, I had my doubts, and I looked and I just said, you know, why him? Like he chose you, man, to pasture his sheep, but you kept faithful with the little things. And now you have a church, and now you have a congregation, and God is lifting you up. You know, you went through the trials and tribulations, and you probably still are now, but now he's lifting you up higher. He's entrusting you now with a church, his church, the body of Christ. So now he's entrusting you to, you know, put the arms, the feet, and built this body of Christ that he ordained. He said, let your kingdom come, let your will be done here on earth like it is in heaven. And now he's entrusting you with that. Bro, isn't that big?
Way big.
It's mind-blowing. An ignorant person that couldn't talk, couldn't see, was on drugs, had HIV, and now God says, he's my son. I sealed him. I called him. I'm not looking for perfection. I am looking for a willing vessel. I trust you. So as a human being, you're like, why me? Do you ever think about that?
I ask God that all the time. Why did you choose me? Why did you take me out from my comfort zone, which I was here in Florida, living a good life, making pretty good money.
Yes.
And in a mega ministry, just, you know, just being there comfortable. And when you stop and you say, and I stop and I say, you know what, God, what is it you want with me? I know I got a calling to be a pastor, but then I also know that I am called for business. What is it you want? Because I'm not giving 100% to any. And he tells me, hey, pick up your things and leave to Jersey. Everybody thought I was crazy.
Yeah, Even me.
Everybody, yeah.
What is he running from? Like, you he's know, called here. He's anointed here. And look.
And
it's amazing.
I went into a lab. But, you know, it was the one moment in my life there that I was like, maybe after 6 months that I was there, Christmas was coming along. Financially, we weren't doing well. And at the same time, I got robbed in my car for all my daughter's Christmas gifts.
Wow.
And you find yourself in that challenge. And I'm like, I'm not calling anybody to ask for money to help me. And God came through. But then there was another day that I was like, God, this is ugly. I mean, you can't come, you know, for all the Philly people out there, I love Philly. I love Jersey. Don't get me wrong. That's my hometown. I don't want to come to Florida anymore.
Right.
You know, it's like, yeah. I just want to come through, pass by. But it was just crazy. You know, you can't compare the households. You can't compare the way the city looks to what Philly looks like. Philly right. looks like you've been in through a war zone.
Wow.
You know, in some of the parts in Jersey. And I'm driving and I'm like, man, God, he's like, why did you bring me to this ugly place? Wow. I know I grew up in the ghetto,
right.
but eventually, you know, you took me out the ghetto. I'm living in a good area of Florida,
right?
You know, and I know, you know, and I said to the Lord, I was like, I know you could take the nigga out the ghetto, but you don't, you
right,
know,
right.
But the ghetto never leaves him. And I'm like, why do you bring me here?
Right.
And I asked the Lord that, and you know, and that morning I had this guy come into my car. And I look at him through the mirror and I'm like, whoa, what is this? You know, and I'm looking at him, all I can see is his bright eyes just looking at him in a smile, and I can't detect who he is. So I try to look for a conversation. He had this big book bag on him. He threw it in the back of the seat of the van that I was in. And I start taking him, and this to make the story short.
Yeah,
he looks at me. He's like, "What brings you in these areas?" So I tell him, you know, what brought me in the area.
Yeah.
But the most powerful thing was that he looks at me. He's like, "Wow, it's amazing, in a land that, in my eyes, does not look like it has a promise.
Wow.
You were willing to bring you and your family here." And I'm like, I never told this man that I had a family.
Wow.
And I looked at him and I said, excuse me, can you speak to me again?
Yeah.
What is it you said? He's like, in a land that in men's eyes do not look like it has a promise, you brought your family here. And in that moment, I stayed in shock and I'm like, whoa. And at that moment, as I'm driving, I'm like, man, I gotta touch this person. I'm driving to where his destination was, which it was the airport. I was like, I got to touch this person.
Yeah.
And I turn around and I'm going to give him one of my business cards to touch him. And he just gives me my whole address.
Wow.
When he gives me my whole address, I'm like, whoa. But I didn't fall in like in a shock. Like, he gave me his address. He told me this. That came through in the middle of the night when I was preaching. That I was testifying of the experience that I had because he disappeared in my face.
An angel. Yeah, you were entertaining an angel.
You know, and I'm like, whoa. And when he disappeared in my face, I'm like, whoa, this is something supernatural. And I started crying.
Yeah.
And as I testified, I'm like, a land that in man's eyes look like it does not have a promise. Wow. See, when God calls you for something, he has a promise. No matter what man tells you, there's no purpose. I got to Jersey, and somebody told me, man, it's been 28 years you've been serving God, and nothing has come through.
Wow.
And I looked at the person, and I'm like, what do you think I'm doing here?
Right, right.
You know, so I look at what God has given me, and I fear it. I fear. I say, Lord, you know, it fears me, you know, that if I bring something to the altar,
right,
that is wrong. It fears me that if I impart upon them something that is wrong. It fears me if I teach them religion, but not just live a life of freedom.
Yes.
With Christ.
Yeah.
And the Holy Spirit. And that's one of the things that I seek in more. But yeah, the fear is always there. The fear, I'm like, whoa. And when I see what God's doing and I see where God wants to take us.
Yeah.
I'm like, whoa, this is crazy. This is crazy. Am I going to be able to do this? Like my brother told me, how do you feel when you drive somewhere and you just look at all these signs and you don't know what they say? How do you feel when you open the word Yeah. And you don't know what it says. I'm like, I feel like I'm in China.
Wow.
So I got to put my trust in God.
100%.
I got to listen and put my ears sharp for I could be able to let God speak through me. And one day I said, Lord, you know what? You've given me all this wisdom and so many things.
Mm-hmm.
Why can't I read and write? He says, because the day you read and write, you will think for your own mind.
Wow. He uses the foolish things, the word of God, to confound the wise, man. Man, that's crazy. You're a living testimony of that, man. Listen, again, if you didn't tell me, I would have never guessed. We ministered together. I've seen you preach. I've seen you open up the Bible. I've seen God use you. You've quote the word of God on point. It wasn't like you kind of mixed this one. I have my master's in theology, my doctorate in biblical studies. I've watched you preach, and I'm like, man, this guy is solid. Not only solid of in the word of God, but hearing the voice of God. And it's just being so accurate, man. And I thank you for being open and talking about how you were entertaining an angel, because when people have entertained angels before that are not even saved, but they're afraid to talk about it because people are going to think they're crazy. Because I think that if more and more people start talking about their supernatural encounters, man, they're going to really start knowing and understanding that God is real. He exists. And just like he got your attention, allowing you, because God wasn't the one that gave you AIDS. God wasn't the one that allowed you to go through all these circumstances. God didn't allow you to all these things. What happened is God allowed it to happen for you to finally look up and say, God, I give up. I tried on my own. There's nothing else that I can do. All I can do is trust you. And when you become that willing vessel and then you have feet of clay, then God can use you. And the people are probably looking at you right now. And, oh, he's not qualified. Guess what? God doesn't look for qualification.
I mean,
he qualifies the disqualified.
Yeah. I mean, if you could turn out to it, you know what I mean? Like what Jesus did.
Yeah.
How many people said he wasn't qualified?
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. How many people said he wasn't qualified? And look. Yeah.
Not only that, the disciples. Why did he choose to use unlearned men? And it's all for people to know that it's all about him. That's why he uses the foolish things, the word of God, to confound the wise. So he'll use, man, he's in the business of restoration, man, in the business of healing. And he wanted to heal you because he knew that you were going to give him the glory. He wanted to set you free from your addictions because he knew you were going to give him the glory. He made you a pastor, and he's going to make you a pastor of pastors, but he made you a pastor because he knew you were going to give him the glory, the honor, and the praise, man. And Pastor Josh, man, I thank you, man. It's 7:45. I know you got to preach in a little bit, but I want to switch a little bit quickly into Spanish.
Definitely.
And I want to ask, ¿cómo tú te sientes como pastor en tu iglesia?
You want me to translate?
Yes. I just said it in Spanish, but yeah.
Okay. How do you feel as me being your pastor?
Yeah.
Yo me siento muy contento, muy feliz de que él sea mi pastor.
Okay.
Porque es un hombre de Dios.
Amén.
Y bueno, él habla mucho de la relación con el Espíritu Santo.
Amén. Y tú sabes, quiero decir algo. Hay muchos pastores que no hablan del Espíritu Santo. Hablan de Dios, hablan del Hijo, pero muy poco del Espíritu Santo.
There's a lot of pastors that don't speak about the Spirit of God. They speak about God, they speak about Jesus, but they do not speak very little bit about the Spirit of God. And as he was saying, he says that I am a person that constantly speaks about the Spirit of God.
También de habla mucho del destino y el propósito que Dios nos creó a nosotros.
And Amen. He always speaks about the purpose and the destiny that God created us to complete.
Y tú sabes, you know why that's important?
¿Sabe por qué eso es importante?
It's because if you don't know who you are,
porque si tú no sabes quién tú eres,
why you're here,
por qué tú estás aquí,
and where you're going,
y a dónde tú vas,
you don't know your purpose in life.
Tú no sabes tu propósito.
See, a lot Cristo. Of churches, they tell you, come to church and serve coffee and do this and do that. That's not your purpose.
Muchas iglesias te dicen, ven a la iglesia, ven, sirve el café, sirve al esto. Ese no es tu propósito.
Your purpose is to identify if you have an office.
El propósito tuyo es identificar si tienes un llamado.
If you're an apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher, evangelist.
Si eres uno de los cinco ministerios.
The second thing is to identify your gifts.
A identificar tu dones.
You have a lot of churches that the people are just there. It's a good gathering, but no one knows their gifts.
Hay muchas iglesias que es una reunión tan linda, pero no hay nadie conoce los dones de la gente.
And the gifts are not for you; it's for you to bless others.
Y los dones no son para ti, son para tu bendecir otros.
So you see how God has blessed your pastor to talk on the things of God, how he wants to raise his kingdom here on earth.
Ve como el Señor usa tu pastor para hablar de las cosas para levantar el reino de Dios.
¿Y el nombre de usted otra vez?
Leonardo Antunes.
Leonardo, ¿cómo te siente él siendo tu pastor, Pastor Josh?
Bendecido. Sí.
Usted está,
how do you feel, Pastor Joshua, being your pastor? Blessed.
¿Usted está en el ministerio? ¿Haces algo en el ministerio?
Do you do something in the ministry?
Sí, sirvo en la iglesia.
Silver, ¿qué es lo que haces?
Soy ujiero.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. He's practically a new believer.
Wow.
I mean, not that long ago, he gave his life again to the Lord. Wow. And since he walked in, he's just been growing.
So you're telling me he didn't have to read 30 books and he didn't have to sit through 60 classes.
Now, the only process he had to go through was having a willing heart for God.
Praise God, man.
El único propósito que él estuvo para poder servir en la iglesia fue tener un corazón dispuesto para servir a la iglesia, which that's one of the biggest problems nowadays in the church.
Yes.
You got to go through this process. You got to go through baptism. You got to go through this, you know, and it's not that. You know, if God forgive you, why should I still keep condemning you?
That's it. Amen. Y eso es algo tan importante para el ministerio de la iglesia.
That is something that's very important for the ministry of church.
Y yo sé que ahora el pastor tiene que predicar.
I know that the pastor has to go out and preach. I'm not preaching. I have to be at the meeting.
Okay, que tiene que estar en la iglesia, pero lo vamos a invitar y lo quiero invitar a ustedes otro día para hablar más profundo, estar dos y tres horas, para de verdad tocar en I want to touch on some subjects.
Definitely.
And I want to talk about where God, now that, you know, we spoke about your past a little bit and the miracles that God has done. Man, I want to know the visions that God has given you, man. The purpose that God has given you. So you can bless us, bless the listeners, bless the viewers, man. So we're going to have to get you back, man, soon, brother. So I want to thank you for coming out.